I left the Pentagon on July 17th, so I've been out of the business for 3.5 months. This is the first time that I've spoken in a public forum. I've spoken a lot of off the record for, but this is the first time. So it's actually good to be in a room. I know many of the faces here. And my overriding, I wanted to decompress, but the biggest kind of feeling when I left the Pentagon, and this was only as a result of my time as the Deputy Secretary, is that for 3 years I was a toddler. I got driven to and from work. I had a 24-hour security detail and comms detail that had to, and so if I went to a restaurant, they'd take me to the restaurant. They'd take me, drive me to the tarmac, I'd get on an airplane, I'd fly. It was like, hey mom, I want to go to Chuck E. Cheese. And it just happened. And so, on the first day out, I went to my car, I went to the driver's side rear seat, opened the door, got in, and the car didn't move. And so I had to learn how to drive again. I had to listen to Siri. So it's taken me about 3 months to get back to feeling like, I'm actually ready to come back into society. Duncan, as you said, asked me to follow up on rethinking the future environments and security challenges of the United States and international security. And my first message to you is, wow, it is time for the United States and for the Department of Defense to cowboy up. Now, in rethinking the future environments, I watched General Hayden's speech. He really came at the issue from the perspective of an intelligence professional and what he might tell the president about what is happening inside the world. My thoughts are going to be informed primarily from my time in the Department of Defense, specifically as the Deputy Secretary when I was responsible for creating the program and budget along the lines that the Secretary wanted. I served with three different secretaries, Secretary Hagel, Secretary Carter, and Secretary Mattis. Each of them had their own leadership style, and each of them had their own ideas on what is important in the program. But what you'll hear tonight is really going to be informed by that kind of interaction. Now, I'm forced to choose, just to let you know, if someone said, what type of national security or foreign policy school do you follow? I probably would follow the realist school if I was forced to change. So I just want to let you know on that. And like Ralph Peters, I like to take a GPS approach to strategy. I want to know exactly where I am before I start to talk about anything. And I'd add, I want to know how we got here. So I'm going to give this brief in two chapters, a prologue and two chapters. I'm going to talk about the end of the post-Cold War era. We are now out of the post-Cold War era. I don't know what to call the new era. I'm going to call it the global era tonight, but we are no longer in that era. So chapter one, look, defense forecasting is dicey at any given time, but especially with all the changes going on in the world, looking out 30, 40, 50 years, to me, that is really problematic. I'm comfortable saying, hey, look, the post-Cold War era lasted 25 years. So I'm just going to ask myself, how do I think the next 25 years is going to differ in kind than the last 25 years? And that is a question that I think we can all answer and debate. And then what must the Department of Defense do to prepare and compete in what I'll call the global era? But I put a question mark behind it because I'm sure someone is going to come up with a cool name sooner or later. So in the beginning, the Cold War ended on May 12th, 1989 from the Department of Defense perspective. That day, President George H.W. Bush, at the commencement speech at Texas A&M, said the following: we're going to move beyond containment to a new policy for the 90s. Containment no longer influenced the development of the defense program. So from the Department of Defense's perspective, that was the end of the Cold War. Some people call it when the Berlin Wall falls down in November 1989. Others say with the dissolution of the Soviet Union. But from the Department of Defense perspective, this was guidance from the Commander-in-Chief that said, start to have a new program and start to think differently about how you develop the program. And that was the beginning of the post-Cold War era. Now, we're going to talk about this and all good things. This was a very, very advantageous era for for United States interests in the world. In fact, it's hard to imagine any era that was more advantageous to the United States and its interests. But in 2014, in the early part of 2014, China started their massive reclamation in the South China Sea. Russia illegally annexes Crimea, starts to destabilize the Ukraine. Both of those actions are consistent with a great power starting to secure their near abroad. So in my view, that day, or that year, marked the end of the post-Cold War era and started a new era. Now we're 3 years into this new era, and we're still bound by a national defense strategy that was written in January 2012, before ISIS, before the illegal annexation of Crimea. What is going on? With all the things we have in the world, the fact that we don't have a new guiding national security strategy for this new era tells you just how strategically backward we are right now. One of the things that resonated most to me in General Hayden's speech was he said, look, these 16 years of war has really created an instance where our whole national security apparatus is operationally and tactically oriented. We don't think in terms of big strategic thoughts anymore. He gave the example, for those of you who weren't here, he said when the Russians went into Donbass, he said, hey, I want to use national technical means to DF the Russian flot. In other words, he wanted to use national technical means to use ELINT and all sorts of other things to tell him where Russian units were. And we couldn't do it. National technical means had been tuned to low power push-to-talk radios and cell phones in the mountainous regions of Afghanistan and the urban canyons of Iraq and Syria. And he used this as an example that said, we are now so tactically focused in our national security apparatus that we really need to kind of step back and say, what do we need to do to change? Now, this last 25 years was relatively coherent. I think historians will look back and say, hey, there are certain things about this period that stand out. And what I'm going to do is use an article called The Upheaval by Hal Brands and Eric Edelman. Both of them I respect very much. They're strategists and foreign policy experts who I respect. And they wrote The Upheaval in the National Interest in July, August of this year. And they said, hey, look, looking back nostalgically, there were four characteristics of this period. Now, yes, it waxed and waned. But first, uncontested U.S. primacy on the world stage. They start in 1994 when the U.S. possessed 25% of the world GDP and controlled 40% of global defense outlays, and the allies associated with the United States had 47 and 35% respectively. So over 70% of the economic output of the world was centered on the U.S. and its allies, and over 70% of all military expenditures were the U.S. and its allies. It was unbelievable. There was absence of any international ideological competition to the degree of the Cold War. There was the absence of great power competition. Russia was really reeling from the dissolution of the Soviet Union and went through what they called the period of troubles, and China simply wasn't strong enough. And there was generally good multilateral cooperation on addressing global disorder. So these four things, according to Brands and Edelman, and I agree with them 100%, these four things were the primary characteristics of the post-Cold War era. So, first chapter. How might the next 25 years resemble or differ from the last 25? And again, I'm going to borrow from Brands and Edelman. No matter what you say, there's going to be erosion of U.S. and Western primacy. It's happening now. Right now, the share of GDP and defense spending has declined to 22 and 34%, so it's about 66, down from a high of over 70. And our allies have really seen a decrease. They're now at 39 and 25, so they're just in the 60s. We are still the preeminent power in terms of what the Chinese refer to as comprehensive national power, or CNP. We are the preeminent single nation. But the primacy that we enjoyed in the post-Cold War, without question, is eroding. Great power competition is back with a vengeance. Now, I use the definition, a realist definition of great powers. The world is just divided between great powers and minor powers. And then there are superpowers. Okay, a great power is a state that can take on the dominant state conventionally. Not necessarily defeat them, but grievously hurt them, and has a nuclear deterrent force capable of a survivable and assured second strike. Now that is a perfect definition for a Deputy Secretary of Defense, because I don't have to debate about soft power. I don't have to debate about economic, global power, global purchasing parity. I don't have to worry about that. I'm looking at hard power. And that's the way the realists generally look at these type things. So that's the definition of great power. And under those definitions, both Russia and China meet the definition of a great power. Both of them conceive of themselves as great power, and both of them are increasingly acting as though great powers in histories have acted. Global ideological struggles have returned, and this is something that I do not believe that we pay attention to. The spread of democracy has stalled. The end of history that we all celebrated in the 1990s, and we felt that democracy was the final and best global governance model, it was assured, is no longer nearly so assured. Between 1974 and 2000, the number of electoral democracies tripled from 39 to 120. But it stayed that way. And since 2006, more countries have seen declines in their democratic values than they have seen in increases. And authoritarianism is making a big comeback. Now, between 1940 and 1989, half of the dictatorships in the world occurred through coup d'états. That was the general way in which authoritarian governments came into power. But since then, I want to get their names right. Erica Franz and Andrea Kendall Taylor, writing in Survival, they said, look, what is happening now is that 40% from 2000 and 2010, the number of states that went authoritarian through what they refer to as authoritarianization was 40%, and that equaled the number of coup d'etats. And they define authoritarianization as you start with a subtle but steady erosion of democratic values and practices, and it just happens over time. It's happened in Turkey. It's happened in Hungary. It may be happening in Poland. Meanwhile, you have Bashar Assad, Kim Jong-un, President Xi, President Putin, they are the authoritarian act, they're the axis of authoritarianism. And they are leading and encouraging this authoritarianization across the world. So we are in a true ideological battle with our democratic Western liberal values and ideas and governance with authoritarianism, and it is making a big comeback. Then there's all sorts of ideological struggles when it comes to religious, religion ideologies, et cetera. And there's been a general intensification of global disorder. And the fifth thing, and this is important to all of us, is that Brands and Edelman say there is a pronounced uncertainty about the willingness and the staying power of the chief defenders of the post-Cold War system, primarily the United States and its allies. There now is a lot of uncertainty. So that uncertainty is really starting to make the ideological struggle between democracies and authoritarian powers even more concerning and perhaps alarming. Now, there are probably other things, but I found this article in one short article. I said, yep, I agree with what you're saying in the post-Cold War period, and I can see everything that you're saying, and that seems to me that the next 25 years, I think you've kind of nailed it. And these are very consistent with the talk that General Hayden gave last time. Now, it's fashionable to declare that this is the most dangerous international security environment in the last 70 years. I've heard several people say this. Man, I got to tell you, you talk to people in the Cold War, I mean the real Cold Warriors, and they say, really? Okay, how many ISIS fighters did you have in Iraq and Syria? 35 to 40,000. Oh, cool. Well, in 1986, we had 39,000 nuclear weapons that were aimed at the United States. So are you telling me that 35 to 40,000 jihadis running around in the desert are as an existential threat as that? Not in your life. If you take a look between 1965 and 1972 and what our country went through with Vietnam, we lost Egypt and Syria to the Soviet Union. They became Soviet client states. The PLO turned to terrorism after the 1967 war. They were the ISIS and Al-Qaeda of their day. Korea, are you kidding me? I mean, they're shooting down our planes, they're doing the Pueblo, they're chopping off American soldiers' heads with axes. You take a look at all of that stuff and you say, oh my gosh. I mean, I was on Okinawa when the axe incident occurred, and we just didn't send over show of force missions. There were B-52s flying around with nukes. I mean, this was, in my view, a much different feeling than we have right now. But like Henry Kissinger said in 1969, what is happening is the current international environment is in turmoil because its essential elements are all in flux simultaneously. In other words, the four things that we said were the kind of primary essential elements of the post-Cold War period are all in flux right now. And so we are in turmoil. It is unstable. So I think it's pretty safe to say, no matter what we think, that the next 25 years is going to be far more challenging to the United States than the last 25 years. And grand strategy is once again in fashion, or it should be. So this is what I mean by the U.S. must cowboy up. It is time for us to raise our strategic game. And right now, we are really focused on operations and tactics, and to my view, not to the broader grand strategic aims that we're trying to accomplish as a nation. Now, there are at least seven big national security challenges that I believe that you can foresee over the next 25 years. And I'm going to go through each of them really quickly. You can see them here, and as I said, there might be more. You might quibble with some of these, but I'm pretty comfortable having talked with combatant commanders, senior people in state, senior people in the White House. These seven things we're going to have to be ready for. So, the first thing is compete with great powers in peace and avoid a great power war. We haven't had a great power war in 70 years, and that's probably a good goal for the next 70 years. Yes, sir? I did? I'm going to do them one by one. So these are the seven, and I'm going to go through them one by one. So we can talk about this in the question and answer period, but it seems clear that China is pursuing a new Sino-centric regional order. It envisions itself as one of, if not the key, international rulemaker by 2050. Russia is contesting key aspects of the post-Cold War era. It's solidifying control of its near abroad. And although these two great powers are not in a formal counter-coalition, both are questioning and contesting U.S.-led international order, and they are cooperating in a wide variety of different ways, technologically, militarily, and in some cases, foreign policy-wise. Now, whenever you are faced with great power competition, your freedom of action is constrained. Every move that you make strategically, you have to calculate how it may impact your position vis-a-vis the other great powers. And unlike the Cold War, where we really only had to worry about one peer competitor, We have to worry. I wouldn't call Russia a peer competitor, but I do consider them a great power. And you have to worry about how those two perceive what U.S. is doing. Actions by the United States that force China and Russia into a formal counter-coalition would be a very, very bad thing. So your freedom of action is constrained. The key end is compete, confront, and contest these great powers. Not give them a pass. You have to compete with them on a daily basis. You have to confront them when they are doing things that are antithetical to our interests and are the interests of our allies. And you have to contest their longer, broad vision of the way the world should evolve. And you have to do this while avoiding a great power war. Now, I believe none of the two. And this is a key thing. I had this debate inside the department all the time. I consider Russia and China as geopolitical rivals and not adversaries. They are acting like a great power acts. Of course they are going to vigorously defend what they consider to be their vital interests. There's absolutely no reason for us to get ourselves into a great power war unless it's through miscalculation or some kind of misunderstanding. So we have to maintain strategic parity because that's the basis for strategic deterrence. We have to strengthen conventional deterrence, just like in the 1980s when the Soviet Union achieved nuclear parity with the United States. We started to worry much more about the conventional balance to make sure that we did not induce an unexpected attack by the Soviet Union because they thought that they would be able to achieve their gains conventionally. But the joint force definitely has to prepare for ambiguous gray zone type challenges. And just like in the Cold War, we have to be prepared for proxy wars against clients of either China or Russia. It is probably far more likely we would get into a proxy war than it would be into a direct confrontation with a nuclear-armed great power. Now, the second challenge is we have to deter and respond to both old and new means of strategic attack. Look, nukes are going to be around for a while. Let's get over it. We have to maintain a strong nuclear deterrent. Now, both Russia and China conceive of strategic cyber attacks in terms of counter-value warfare. Cyber attacks against the industry, against the electrical grids, against the economy. Counter-value strikes. I believe this puts us at a disadvantage because we moved away from counter-value targeting in the nuclear realm a long time ago. And we don't think in terms of counter-value. And for those of you who aren't cold warriors, counter-value means cities and the society. Counter-force are attacks against nuclear forces or military forces. It's clear that China and Russia believe that strategic cyber are counter-value weapons. And we need to really rethink how we think about this. I believe that we have started to see the first of very sophisticated societal and governance cohesion attacks, primarily through what you see the Russians doing to the United States over the last 12 months or so. These attacks are going to become more sophisticated with the introduction of artificial intelligence, and I'll talk about this later. But it is something concerning to me because, once again, it is a subject that a democracy does not enjoy talking about. We have to deter and respond potentially to genomic population attacks. We'll talk about how genomics are changing, but there are people who think about making weapons, weaponizing genomics so that they can attack specific aspects of a population. We have to be thinking about that, even though it makes you sick to your stomach. So we're going to have to think hard about a new theory of deterrence. My colleagues at the Telemus Group, they're using a term called lattice deterrence because There's all sorts of different escalatory ladders for each of these things: cyber, nuclear, genomic attacks, societal and governance cohesion attacks. And what happens is they start to form a lattice. And we have to have a theory about how we have escalation and de-escalation control in this very, very, very challenging strategic environment. And while this is happening, the distinction between away and a home game, this is the way the Department of Defense has always thought about it. You know, Department of Homeland Security, Coast Guard, you kind of got the home game. Yeah, we got Northern Command. They'll take care of ballistic missiles. But we're going to fight the away game, and we're going to keep the guys from getting to our shores. But that doesn't happen now. I mean, if we got into a big dust-up with a great power, we'd be under attack from the moment our forces started to move, if not before. So I think more attention over this next 25 years is going to be paid to Homeland Defense. The Department of Defense will inevitably get drawn more and more into that mission, and that means we're going to have to divert resources away from other defense activities. Okay, look, the Middle East is a strategic cul-de-sac for the United States. We have been drawn into that cul-de-sac, and we have been sitting there for a long, long time. Right now, there's competition for regional hegemony between Tehran and Riyadh. It appears as though the United States has thrown in with Riyadh and the Sunnis. I don't believe that there was really any type of a debate about this, and I think that was wrong. There's been a great breakdown in governance all the way from West Africa to Afghanistan. You know the sectarian strife between the Shia and the Sunni and the Islamic faith. You have ISIS, Al-Qaeda, and you'll have son of ISIS. And increasingly, you'll see more great power competition in this area. We must, in my view, as part of a broader strategic view of the world and a focus on great power competition, we must accomplish our goals over the next 25 years at a more economical cost in terms of both defense resources and forces. The draw is quite extraordinary. The amount of money that we have put into the Middle East is quite extraordinary. And we're going to have to contend with nuclear-armed minor powers. We're focused right now on the DPRK, which is a hostile power with a demonstrated nuclear capability. We have hostile powers that aspire to have a nuclear capability, like Iran. We have unstable powers with a demonstrated nuclear capability, like Pakistan. And depending on how the great power competition goes, friendly nations may start to pursue an independent nuclear capability. What will this mean for U.S. extended deterrence? So regional nuclear deterrence is going to remain a critical focus in the next 25 years. And we're going to have to think through, just at the strategic level, we're going to have to think through what extended deterrence is going to look like in this very, very, very nasty potential nuclear world. The other thing the department is dealing with is the culmination of what I refer to as the guided munitions battle network revolution. It was a revolution. We can debate this. But in my view, the first question you ask, was it a revolution, is did it supplant the dominant form of warfare or not? And if you are an army stuck in the unguided weapons warfare regime, like Iraq, and you run up against a U.S. guided munition, theater-wide guided munitions battle network, you are nothing but a series of targets. Now, I'm talking about conventional warfare here. And what's happened is Andy Marshall would always call this the maturation of the regime. The maturation of the regime occurs when all of the competitors have the same tools. And a lot of it has to do with how fast it can be duplicated. So the Germans, hey, everybody knew there was radio. Everybody knew there was mechanization. Everybody knew there was mechanization. But only the Germans said, hey, if you combine it this way, you can have a new operational concept called Blitzkrieg. And they had an enormous operational and tactical advantage for about 4 years. But once everybody saw what the Germans did, they could say, well, I can do Blitzkrieg too. In fact, I can do it a little bit differently, and I can do it a little bit better. And so by 1944, both the Soviets and the United States are out-blitzkrieging the Germans. Once everybody saw it, it was relatively easy to copy. The carrier revolution was a little bit different. There were two primary competitors in the carrier revolution, Japan and the United States. Once Japan was taken off the table, the United States had 100 aircraft carriers. And so everybody said, well, yeah, we could probably compete with them in aircraft carriers. And we might be able to build five aircraft carriers that are better than any aircraft carrier they have. But they would still have 100. So why don't we go after anti-ship cruise missiles and submarines and go after the carrier? Well, this one, the guided munitions battle network revolution, was one of scale. The United States could do this at the theater level and do 24-hour, all-weather, guided munitions bombardment. Nobody could actually keep up with us. And we rode that for 25 years. Now both the Chinese and the Russians have achieved near parity with us in guided munitions and battle network warfare. And moreover, all of the technologies that drive guided munitions and battle networks are now pretty much widely proliferated. So as a result, our conventional overmatch is receding. And any time that we project power, it's going to be more costly and more difficult. We're going to operate in newly or more hotly contested domains. I'll name three of them for sure. Space, no longer sanctuary. You probably all talked about this. Near space. The Chinese said, hey, look, there's an operational domain that the United States doesn't even operate in. It's above 100,000 feet where airplanes can't fly, and it's below about 320,000 feet where spacecraft can't stay in orbit. We are going to dominate this regime by going after hypersonics. And holy crap, the national impetus or push they put behind this is just astounding. And as a result, they're well ahead of us in hypersonics, in my view. And they just said, here's a domain, an operating domain that the United States doesn't operate in. We're going to be a first mover here, and we're going to have a big advantage because of it. The electromagnetic spectrum, it's always been contested, but it's contested as never before. The combination of tactical and operational cyber with electronic warfare and information operations is really tough. Now, undersea, that is one of our big domain advantages right now. We are counting on that domain advantage. Over this 25 years, if you get quantum sensors, okay, it may not be it may be a much more contested domain. And all doing this is going to divert resources from other defense activities. And we're in the midst of an enormous technological tsunami. I've listed all of the different things that are going on right now. And this tsunami is definitely, in one way, shape, or form, and maybe in many ways, shapes, or form, going to sweep away old ways of doing business, bring in new ways of doing business, and present the prospect for even more military technical revolutions. I'll talk about this more when we talk about third offset. Okay, so these seven challenges are pretty tough. We know they're here. There may be more, but these are the seven that stood out to me as we tried to figure out how we were going to address them. So how are we going to prepare and compete? First and foremost, this is going to be about institutional resilience, flexibility, and adaptability. The next 25 years is going to be rife with operational and technical surprise. It's going to be a world of fast followers. It's going to be a world where operational advantage is relatively fleeting. You might have an operational advantage for 2 or 3 years, but then you better be ready to be going to something else because your competitors, who will be able to use all of the same technologies that you're using, are going to copy things. And this is why you'll hear Secretary Carter and Secretary Mattis and Secretary Hagel just say, we've got to be more agile. The way the Secretary Mattis talks about it is increasing the velocity of innovation and the velocity of capability delivery to our warfighters. And as important as any institutional or organizational changes that we do or processes, you better get the talent right or you're going to have a big problem here. this force has got to be able to shake off surprise and drive on. So that's the big thing, but I think there's five top operational and programmatic challenges. These are the ones that I would focus on. These are the ones I did focus on. This first sentence is what Secretary Mattis says are his first priority. Rebuild a safe and credible nuclear deterrent while maximizing lethality and readiness of a decisive conventional force. That's his first objective as the Secretary of Defense. So that means you got five things you're going to have to do. You're going to have to recap the nuclear triad. Once again, I'll go through all of these. You're going to have to own the electromagnetic spectrum. You're going to have to prepare to fight and win in space. You're going to have to pursue third offset technologies, especially AI and approved autonomy. And you're going to have to develop operational and organizational constructs for conventional overmatch. I'll go through each of these also. Okay. Unfortunately, we're going to have to recap all three legs of the nuclear triad simultaneously. We can debate on why I think we need a triad in the question and answer period. I'm just going to stipulate now that I believe we need to have a triad. We're replacing every single major component of the triad all simultaneously. And all the service margin is out of the systems that we have. We have slept them. We've kept them around. We've worked them over and over and over again. And all of them start to age out between about 2025 and 2035. You ask me what keeps me up at night? One of the first things that keeps me up is, are we going to be able to execute each of these three major recaps perfectly and deliver them on time, in time, so that the old systems don't age out? I believe that the very viability of our nuclear deterrent is at some risk because we have now gotten to the point where everything has to execute exactly on time. We are assuming that we will build deployable warheads to New START numbers. That's going to be told to us by the Nuclear Posture Review. And it's going to be expensive. Right now, 3% of the defense portfolio is spent on maintaining the three legs of the triad. Oh, between 2021 and 2043, about 20 years, that will grow to 6%. So that means 3% of the defense budget is going to come directly out of the conventional portfolio unless we get additional money just to do the strategic deterrent. We've been arguing that till we're blue in the face. The Navy has done it over and over and over again. We can't build the Ohio replacement unless we get extra money. And each year we get a little bit of extra money, but they say, thank you, Navy, for your interest. You will build a Ohio replacement program. So it's going to be expensive. Now look, in 1975, the Department of Defense said, we're going to own the night. Now if all it was about technology, anybody could have gone out and bought a whole bunch of night vision goggles. But when you own the night, you have to train your forces to operate with night vision goggles. You have to train your squad leaders. You have to have all sorts of control measures at night. It is hard. But within a decade or so, we owned the night. It gave us an extraordinary advantage. So we're going to have to do the same thing. We're going to have to say, as a department, we're going to own the electromagnetic spectrum against anybody we fight against. And man, let me tell you, the Russians and the Chinese are really good at this. We got to cyber harden our DoD networks. Most of them require more extensive cyber hardening. It's taking too long, significant vulnerabilities remain, and the services constantly drop back the time frame because they don't want to spend the money on hardening networks. It's not sexy. But let me tell you, if we get into a war with a great power, they're going to wish they had secure networks. We're going to have to cyber harden the Internet of Things, the DoD Internet of Things. Almost, I'd say 90% of all systems that we have in operation were designed and built in an era where we weren't worried about cyber vulnerabilities. We have to think of cyber hardening just like we thought about EMP hardening in the Cold War. Most legacy systems need to be hardened. And again, the services aren't paying nearly enough attention to them. We have to have more and better operational tactical cyber and electronic warfare systems and tools and decoys, and we got to practice against realistic force-on-force training against a near-peer electromagnetic competitor. We've got to get back to the era of MCON, emission control, and electromagnetic deception. We have to fight and win in space. Talking with John Hyten 3 years ago, it was all about changing the culture. Up until then, our Space Force was a service provider. It was a functional command. It, you know, ran the satellites around, and it provided GPS, and it provided communications, and it provided weather. But they didn't think about fighting that constellation. So somebody's probably going to ask you, do you think I ought to have a Space Corps? No. First step, Air Force Subunified Space Command. Build a more resilient architecture with battle management and command and control so that you can look up and fight that constellation under attack. And then have another organization focused down to provide space-based combat support. And we have to be able to take the fight to the enemy by going after their systems. Now, the third offset technologies, especially AI and improved autonomy. AI and autonomy, in my view, is going to be the pacing technological competition between great powers in the 21st century as nuclear weapons were in the 20th century. How many people have read the Chinese AI plan that was published, I think, on July 20th? Okay, you all need to get it, and you got to read it. Let me tell you what it says. This is a national plan. In 2020, we will catch up to the Americans. In 2025, we will surpass the Americans. By 2030, we will dominate it. When I read this thing, the only thing that kept popping in my mind was Nikita Khrushchev taking off his shoe and saying, "We will bury you." And they are putting money to this like you would not believe. The Russians, what Vladimir Putin said is, artificial intelligence is the future, not only for Russia, but for all humankind. It comes with colossal opportunities, but also threats that are difficult to predict. Whoever becomes the leader in this sphere will become the ruler of the world. Now you say, was he just using hyperbole? Well, if you think about societal and governance cohesion attacks, Putin said that. When you think about the stuff that the Russia is able to do now, when you add on AI and autonomous bots, I think what he's saying is, look, authoritarian regimes will be able to thrive in this AI autonomous world. And all you gotta do is look what the Chinese are doing. They're doing a social credit score. You know, they monitor everything you do, and you know, you have a 840 number, you've got good social credit. You can get jobs in state institutions, but if you have a 120, well, you're just shit out of luck. So this AI and autonomy, both at the societal level and the industry, AI and autonomy is going to drive the fourth industrial revolution, and it will clearly have an impact on everything that DoD does across the ROMO. We can talk about all of these different aspects of how it will play in the question and answer. But believe me, our great power competitors recognize AI and autonomy, and they're striving for first mover advantage. And that's why I say, look, this race is going to, I think, define our great power competition in the 21st century, just like nuclear competition helped define. Now, I happen to work on the board of advisors of a company called Govini. What Govini does is it has a crawler that can go through every single contract that the government lets. And it can tell you exactly how much money has been contracted, what it's been contracted for, down to the part number if you want to have it. So I asked him, how are we doing in AI and autonomy? This was their first cut. Their crawler made a first cut. So this is hard to read. It's data processing, data collection and processing, cloud service models. You got to have the cloud so you can really exploit machine learning, advanced computing, database services. You have to take care of your data, machine learning and artificial intelligence and analytics. The numbers that are, the arrows are the 5-year compound adjusted growth rate. So I take a look at this and say, hey, $6 billion in 2017. Okay, that's pretty good. But then I say, how is this comparing as a nation against China's investments? And I'm not so happy. And this, I think we need to be spending a lot more money and more smartly than we are now. Now the other thing, AI and autonomy is going to have a major impact on our battle networks in the near term, primarily through what I'll call human-machine collaborative combat networks. It is happening now, it will happen at an ever-increasing pace, and it will increase the operations of our battle networks to a measurable degree. That's my supposition and hypothesis. The next over the hill is that AI is going to merge. So if you take AI and quantum physics, you're going to have accelerated machine learning. Now, has everyone heard about AlphaGo Zero and AlphaGo? So 2,500 years of playing Go. The expectation was that it was such a nuanced game that only humans would be able to win, that the computers would never be able to do it. But just a little while ago, I think a couple of years ago, AlphaGo beat a grandmaster, Lee Sedol, 4-1. So the human acquitted himself pretty good. He won 20% of the time. You know, he'd be on most baseball teams. You know, 200 batting average, not too bad. But the machine did it better. It took, what happened was you trained AlphaGo on 30 million games that have occurred between grandmasters and everything. You trained AlphaGo on 30 million games, and it was able to beat a human grandmaster 4-1. AlphaGo Zero, what it does is it does self-learning. The only thing it told AlphaGo Zero was this is the rules of the game, and AlphaGo Zero started to play against itself. In 4 days, 4 million games against itself, it beat AlphaGo 100-0. So quantum computing is going to accelerate machine learning, which is already accelerating at an astonishing rate. And you're going to have novel complex systems. AI and neuroscience, all sorts of human-machine symbiosis. AI and synthetic biology, nanotechnology, and additive manufacturing, you're going to be able to manufacture stuff right at the point of use. AI and material science, we're going to fabricate materials with novel aspects that we can't even understand right now. And AI and social media is going to get us closer and closer to the ability to manipulate human behavior in societies. The battle for talent is going to be intense, but we have to get serious about this as a nation. Now, why is this a programmatic thing? Because just like Blitzkrieg, just like air-land battle, just like carrier aviation, it wasn't about people pursuing technological silver bullets. It was about operators thinking about a problem and using these technologies to come up with new ways of doing business that provided them with operational advantage. It's the group that can make these operational, and it's the competitor that can make these operational and organizational constructs. And as I said, own the night, set 1975. Maybe it takes us a decade to do it. That's really fast. When you think about .milf, you know, doctrine, organization, tactics, logistics, and all of the stuff that went into fighting and winning at night, doing that in a 10-year period was pretty astounding. So it's the competitors who are going to be able to inject all of these technologies into new operational concepts. So why I consider this a programmatic issue is because you have to incentivize the services to go after these. That's why we set up the Warfighting Lab Incentive Fund. If the Marine Corps Warfighting Lab said, we want to redo, what was the Sea Dragon? That was the one in the late 90s, Sea Dragon, where all these little groups of small squads had access to long-range fires. We want to do that with AI and autonomy injected into it. But we only have a couple million dollars. We would double it. We'd give them $2 million. And say, go out and do it. We want to see what you do. Same thing on the War Gaming Incentive Fund. We wanted to use war gaming to test new operational concepts. And I'm telling you right now, if the Department of the Army came to the Department of Defense and said, we are going to take a BCT offline, and we are going to make that into a multi-domain vanguard force. We're going to do everything we can. We're going to do the training. We're going to figure out how to do it. We're going to figure out what Airland Battle 2.0 looks like. I guarantee you that it probably would have gotten more resources to do it. You have to create incentives to get these operational and organizational constructs. Now, I'm sure, in fact, I can tell you, I was a minority in the Department of Defense on this. But given all of the things I know we have to do to be more competitive, before we grow another BCT, before we think about going to a 355 ship Navy, before we think about going to a 60 tactical fighter squadron Air Force, before we build 540K active duty Army, look, hone the force you have. You want to have the best led, best trained, best maintained, and most over-provisioned force in the world. You want to pursue a new revolution in training, akin to the revolution in training we had in the 1980s. You cannot tolerate any waivers of certification. Any commanding officer who waivers a certification should be immediately relieved. You have to cut presence before you cut maintenance. Look, I know that the COCOMs want more stuff out there. Yes, they do. In fact, they ask for about 355 Navy's worth of ships. Actually, they ask for about 600 ships worth of ships. But the Navy says, we think we can do most of what you want with 355. Okay, we can argue whether it's 355, 346, 377. But you don't try to get 276 ships to provide the same presence of 355, because you will do what has happened to the greatest Navy on the world, the US Navy. The Navy is in big trouble because of their lack of a focus on maintenance and their lack of focus on training and certifications. And I believe it is primarily due to the incessant demand of ships and us not being able to say no. And we need to fill our magazines to capacity and build war reserve stocks. Now, we have to pursue modest gains in discrete areas. There are not enough Patriot batteries. We need more of them. There are things like that. But look, one of the things that Secretary Rumsfeld said was, he said, I've got this big barrel of Department of Defense capabilities. And the spigot on the barrel is one-third of the way down from the top. I can turn that spigot on and I can get capabilities really rapidly until it comes down to the level of the spigot. Then two-thirds of the barrel I can't use, I can't get to. So before we start growing, let's reposition the spigot in some way so that we can get into our operational reserve and our strategic reserve faster. And that's one of the ways we can get through this period where we need to really hone the force we have, decide what the force of the future looks like, and then get after it then. Now, some people say, we're going to have enough money to address all five of the challenges you talked about, work and grow the force. Okay, here's the best case. Congress agrees to a substantial increase above the Trump administration defense request, which is about $574 billion, $633 in the 050 account. That's all national security. They do away with the BCA caps, because if they raise the money without doing away with the BC caps, then you'll automatically trigger sequestration again. And they pass the appropriation bill by the expiration of the current resolution, December. How many people in the room believe that is going to happen? No, I'm serious. Is there anybody who really thinks that's going to happen? Yeah, I think you're all very smart. Now, the next spec case is they agree on a substantial increase above the Trump administrative defense and non-defense request, and they pass another balanced budget resolution or agreement. 2 years? Who knows? Maybe three. By the expiration of the current CR. That's not nearly as good, because what has happened over the last several cycles is whenever you get a two-year CR, you never make the hard decisions. You always think it will get better in 2 years. So look, if you take a look at all of the defense drawdowns since World War II, the post-Afghanistan-Iraq drawdown is the shallowest drawdown since World War II by a wide margin. But what made it different is we were under CRs, continuing resolutions, 30% of the time since 2012. In other words, we have an 8-month fiscal year right now. This is the first time in history we had a presidential transition under a CR. And we never took the hard decisions we knew we had to take. Without question, we have too much force structure for the budgets that we've had for the last 5 years. But because we always thought it would get better, and now everyone's liquored up because the president has said we're going to have 355 ships, a 540K army, and all of these things. So everyone's all liquored up. Okay, here it goes. But BCA is still the law of the land. And unless we have a BCA, a BBA, something that fixes it, or you get rid of BCA completely, you don't go anywhere. The next best case is Congress says, okay, we're just going to accept what you asked for, President Trump, and pass an appropriation bill by the expiration of the current CR. November is going to all be about tax reform. It's going to suck up all the oxygen in the room. The CR goes out, I think, on the 8th of December. So when is all this going to happen? So the next not so good case, and with apologies to the Martian and apologies to all of the here, the other option is to OCO the shit out of the defense budget. And you can do that, but it's only 1 year money. And what are you going to do? Are you going to start a major force buildup with only the 1 year money? Probably not. And the worst case is what Adam Smith thinks we're headed for towards. He's pretty smart. He thinks we're headed for another long-term or year-long CR. So it's time to cowboy up. Wow. The post-war era saw conditions that were remarkably favorable to our interests. It was a strategic holiday. The international secure environment over the next 25 years is going to be fundamentally more challenging. There's at least 7 big national security challenges, and strategic thought is once again at a premium. And there are 5 operational programmatic challenges that I would recommend to Secretary Mattis. This is where you got to put your money first before you start growing the force real big. You got to hone the force you have. Because, Mr. Secretary, you say, he's told all the chiefs, I want you to operate as though you are at war in 1 week. So you better be ready, and you better be ready to go. So we need to focus on these things, changing the competition in our favor, and really starting to think about things. So, GERF. You know, I was a MAGTAF fire support officer. That's what a Navy ship reports when they're on the gun line. Guns up, ready to fire. It's time for questions, and I'm ready to accept counter-battery fire. And I'm ready to fire back. So thank you.
Okay, 5 quick rules on questions. Number 1, do wait for the microphone so everybody can hear it and we can record it. Number 2, do tell us who you are, give us your name and affiliation. Number 3, we got a lot of people here tonight, so please limit it to 1 question. So don't try to sneak in an A and a B. We know everybody likes to put your question in context, and that's good that you do that, but you got to keep the question, you got to keep the context short, and you do actually have to ask a question. And then finally, please make sure that your question relates to tonight's topic.
Sound like good rules.
How do you do, sir? Mario
Hi.
Fiore.
Mario.
I'm retired. Nuclear weapons. You want to, and you put it as your first bullet, a safe and credible nuclear deterrent. The one thing we're not convinced, particularly with the new electronic means and the high computers and all the things, is how do we know the weapons are going to work? That's a serious issue, obviously. Yeah. Maybe we got to start testing it again.
The question is, how do we know our nuclear weapons are going to work? And the state of supercomputing is to the point where the experts in Sandia Labs and Lawrence Livermore, they are convinced that we understand the basic physics and workings of nuclear explosions, and we are absolutely confident in their ability to operate the way we expect them to. I defer to the experts on this. That's what we did in the 1950s. We created all these labs like Sandia, Lawrence Livermore, you all name them. We're going to have to do the same thing with AI and autonomy now. But none of the experts are arguing for a resumption of nuclear testing, or at least not enough of them to have made any type of an impression on the Department of Defense leadership.
Yes, sir. Thank you. The insights did not occur in the 3.5 months you were self-driving, obviously. Within the Pentagon, can you talk in general terms how well the change, you're talking change, operational change and budgetary change, how well they were accepted?
Well, let me start with my, when I came in as the deputy secretary, the first thing I wanted to do was to really focus and convince the department that it needed to start to focus on great power competition. That was a key aspect of Secretary Hagel's address at the Reagan Defense Forum in November of 2014. And right now, I would say that there's no argument. Everyone is really focused on, we've got to really think about how we compete against these great power competitors, and we have to think about increasing our conventional deterrent. Now, quite frankly, a lot of people didn't like the term third offset strategy. Secretary Mattis said, I like the term third offset, but I don't like the term strategy because I don't think it's a strategy. And I argued with him about this and said, oh yes, it's an institutional, technical, competitive strategy. And he said, well, I don't agree with you. And I said, you're the boss. And I now refer to it as third offset. But when you hear the chairman talk about it, he talks about the erosion of our conventional overmatch all the time. He has in, so that portion of it, everyone agreed with. I mean, I think there's widespread agreement in the department. To my surprise, and I am not ashamed to say it, the U.S. Army is all over third offset thinking. There's something that just came out from their SSI, and that is their Strategic Studies Institute. Is that right, TX? It's called The Third Offset is Closer Than You Think. They're doing all sorts of different experimentation. The Warfighting Incentive Fund and the War Gaming Incentive Fund worked well, and I think stimulated an awful lot of war gaming and thinking about new operational concepts. The place where it is less clear that if that I was successful is on the shifting of resources in major ways. Now, $6 billion on AI, on autonomy, I can track because we've gone back 5 years, and I can track from the time of Secretary Hagel's Defense Innovation Initiative to 17, and you can see a clear change in the amount of investment that has been going into AI and autonomy. The amount of money we put in SCO went from about, I think it was, I don't know, 35 to 40 million a year to well over 3 billion. So we put money in SCO, we put money in the Defense Innovation Initiative, Unit Experimental. So there were all sorts of different things that were going on. So, I don't know, I'd probably grade it as a C+. I think there's, you know, great power competition, everybody understands it. Everybody knows that our conventional deterrence is eroding, they need to get after it. There's all sorts of activity in the department. But as far as the amount of money that is shifting, and I'll tell you where I know I failed, my argument that don't build the force before you hone it, and make sure you know what the new force is going to look like before you buy a lot of legacy crap that is not going to provide you anything, any competitive advantage at all. You know, I would ask questions like, why is the U.S. Marine Corps the only service that is going to go all fifth-gen fighters? Won't most of the time that the Marine Corps is operating, aren't they going to be dropping 250-pound JDAMs on the forehead of ne'er-do-wells in the Middle East? Why do we need a fifth-gen fighter to do that? Why would we expend that kind of money? If we're going to buy a lot of JSFs and F-18s, how are you going to operate them at range? You know, I can't tell you how many times the Navy would come in and say, you know, we're spending 14 to 15% of our Super Hornet force tanking. So I said, well, build a freaking tanker. I mean, how hard is this? And it better be unmanned, because we're not going to waste money on another manned tanker coming off the carrier deck. So I tell you, at the leadership level, they're, I think, a little bit slower than the, say, 05 and 04 level and below, because I think they're ready to get after it. I mean, I really do. So, like I said, C+.
Approaching the third offset, when it's very clear in my 20th century mind to understand the first and second offset. And trying to develop a 21st century mind is not easy, especially when it had a price tag of about $60 billion.
Where did you get $60 billion for what?
To implement the third offset. That's what I read when the third offset came out.
Whoa.
And it appeared that the third offset was a bucket that everything OSD ever wanted to do was thrown in that bucket. And if it's difficult to understand, it's going to be impossible to be funded. Did you experience that? And is there another way to portray it? And I'm talking about understanding to Congress, the four oversight committees, and the iron majors that are really staff, professional staff that can make or break a program like that. And
yeah.
Understanding it now and reading more about the third offset, I'm beginning, it's like Airland Battle when it first came out. It took some study to really understand it. But if it's to be successful, and if time is short to accomplish everything you said, how do you propose that we go forward and explain that to the people that have the resources?
It's a great question. We went at it in two different ways. One way is from an operational description. So in 1972, 1973, all the icons of the defense era at that time, the Johnny Fosters, the Andy Marshall, Jim Schlesinger, Bill Perry, all of those guys, they start what is called a long-range research and development planning program. And for 2 years, they look at all of the stuff that's going out there, and they look at what's happening on the conventional competition in Europe. And they say, in the end, to convince the Soviets that they won't be able to make their campaign objectives, you got one of two choices. You can make nuclear weapons more usable. You have lower yield, neutron bombs, things like that. Or you can go after what they refer to as conventional weapons with near zero miss, what we call today guided munitions. And it was very easy for operators to understand the potential of guided munitions. Yeah, okay, you mean if I drop five bombs, I'm pretty certain all five are going to hit their target. I'm absolutely certain four will hit their target. Okay, I get that. Well, explaining what AI and autonomy will do for you on the battlefield is a much more difficult sell, just theoretically and conceptually. So we restarted the long-range research and development planning program, and the person who led it, ASD for R&E, Assistant Secretary of Defense for Research and Engineering, Steve Welby, what he did is he described what this stuff would allow the force of the future to do, be able to fight from range, be able to have large numbers of low-cost munitions, reintroduce mass on the battlefield, be able to blind the other person's battle line. All of the things, he described it that way. I came at it from the top, and I said, look, we know that a battle network has a sensor grid. Every battle network, doesn't matter whether it's a tactical or a operational. We have a sensor grid. You have a command, control, communications, computer, and intelligence grid, which makes sense of what's happening in the environment and decides what it wants to do for effect. Then it has an effects grid made of the effectors, either kinetic or non-kinetic, and you have a regeneration and sustainment grid. Every single battle network has those grids. We've operated them for 25 years. Everyone understands how they work. What we said was AI and autonomy will allow you to start putting learning machines in each of the grids. Narrow AI, which will improve a specific aspect of that grid. The next thing you're going to be able to do is have human-machine collaboration. You're going to be able to have machines that tell humans how to better make decisions, give them options and allow the human to make better decisions more timely and more rapidly. You're going to have assisted human operations. You're going to be able to bring the power of the network down to an operator, regardless of what they're doing on the battlefield. You're going to have more human-machine combat teaming. You're going to have more manned and unmanned platforms working together. And you're going to have more network-enabled, collaborative, autonomous weapons. You know that you can do those five things. And what you will do is you will start to inject them in all of the grids. And the hypothesis is, at the operational and tactical level, this will provide you with an enormous advantage because you'll be able to operate at a faster tempo and achieve effects that are more relevant. That was the hypothesis. Now, we're telling everybody, hey, do you want to fight from range? Those guys have DF-21s. Do you really want to stand within DF-21 range? No, don't really want to. Rather fight from outside. Okay, well, your F-35s and F-18s, they don't have the legs to do that. So how are you going to do it? So you might have an unmanned system that goes deep. You might have air-to-air refueling. You might decide not to go in and just fire long-range munitions yourselves. And so what we're trying to do is get that spark. After 3 years, what we did is we said we have to show this because we're not getting quite the fire that we thought we would. And it's called Project Maven. Right now, we have more full motion video data than you can possibly imagine. Some of the sensors, like Gorgon Stare, provide you with full motion video of an entire city. Three teams of seven people working essentially full out until they can't look at full motion video anymore can process maybe 15% of that data. In December, we're going to have the first algorithm in the field, and we'll process 100% of the data. And we'll tell the analyst, this is what you need to look at. So we're hoping that that will start to trigger other people and say, oh my goodness, in this narrow AI application, this is really going to help me. So, but it's a hard thing. This is not as intuitive as the guided munitions revolution because you're going to have to show it. Think of your house right now. You have smart thermostats. You have smart refrigerators. You have smart air conditioners. You can walk in and say Alexa, which can communicate with all of those on Wi-Fi. And what you're going to do is, over time, we're putting more and more narrow AI applications into our houses and more narrow applications into our cars. At some point, the house and the car start to look like they have general AI. And that's our hypothesis on our battle networks. The humans will control the battle network, but on the outside, it's going to be operating at such higher tempo that it's going to look much, much different. And I think it's going to be the percentage of unmanned systems that a force has. There's all sorts of different ways this will go. Speaking of that, each of the three great power competitors are going after AI and autonomy and unmanned systems for three different reasons, in my view. The United States is going after them because people are expensive. They're really, really expensive. The more we can replace people with machines, the better it's going to be. We're going to be able to have less loss of life, and we're going to be able to operate without any big problem. The Russians are running out of people. They need robots to replace people. Their demographics are terrible. That's why they have a goal of being 30% of their force structure robotic by 2030. Do I think they're going to get there? No, I don't think they are. But they know where they're in and they know how they got to get there. The Chinese, every single son and daughter in the Chinese military is what we would be called a sole surviving child. We treat sole surviving childs very, very carefully. In the Chinese culture, young people take care of their elderly parents. The Chinese want to save all of their sole surviving children. So each of the three competitors have big incentives to go after this revolution in a big way. And I can't tell you how the competition will unfold. I can just tell you that I know we're in the competition.
Hello. Thank you, sir. Maurizio Geri from ACT NATO. What do you think about the risk of fragmentation inside the alliance because of the authoritarianization of countries, like you said, like Turkey, Hungary, Poland? And what should the U.S. do to avoid this risk of fragmentation, like in European Union we are having now? Thanks.
As the Deputy Secretary, I didn't spend a lot of time getting down into the nuts and bolts of these very important strategic issues. I was focused on I woke up every morning and I say, what are we gonna do today to try to make the joint force better, more lethal, and more ready? That was kind of what motivated me to get up and get driven to work every day. But it's, you know, it is important that the United States, in my view, in this return to what I consider to be now a grand competition between a democratic bloc and an authoritarian bloc, that the United States does everything it can to strengthen the democratic values of our bloc. And this is not the time to be disassembling this Department of State. It's not the time, because you know the Cold War, it was a whole of government grand strategy. And we seem to be reducing more and more of our grand strategy to the military arm. So I believe it's a mistake. I don't know how this will go, but I think we need to be talking more openly about the sliding of our democratic allies, the authoritarianization that it might lead to, because it weakens the entire alliance, and it weakens the democratic bloc.
Bob. Adam Siegel, Insight Through Analysis. When we speak about the great powers, all the comments have been about competition. To what extent do you see cooperation, co-optition, and is that not a Department of Defense issue as sort of a second part of the same question?
Well, that's why, you know, I believe Russia and China are geopolitical rivals that are vigorously defending what they consider to be their vital national interests. There is absolutely no reason why we should not be cooperating with the Russians on a wide variety of things. Counterterrorism, counterproliferation. We need to talk to each other about these, try to get rules of the road, if possible, on cyber and societal and governance cohesion attacks. We have to talk about genomic attacks and how we might deter that from happening. And we ought to be doing the exact same thing with the Chinese. So I do not consider the Russians adversaries, and I don't consider the Chinese adversaries. I consider them, listen, I'll tell you right now, we could take any joint chief that we've had for the last 10 years and say, Alakazam, you are now on the Russian general staff. And they would watch NATO going towards their borders, and they would say, I am alarmed. And what the Russians said is, look, the one thing we will not tolerate is what they consider to be a hostile military coalition on their immediate borders. They have said as long as there is they used to have a 1,000-mile buffer area, now they have maybe a 200-mile buffer area, and sometimes they don't have any buffer at all. So I think sometimes when you're in a competition like this, you have to understand what your competitor is looking at and try to figure out how do we talk and de-escalate. And the same thing on the Chinese. So look, even at the height of the Cold War, we did nuclear reduction treaties with the Soviet Union, even though they were fanning wars of national liberation all over the world, and we were in a knockdown, drag-out fight. In 1972, when Nixon concluded that the United States could no longer lead the Western coalition, and he got rid of Bretton Woods, and you know, we lit wages and price freezes, we did all sorts of things, Vietnamization. How did we get out of it? We went to China. We change the rules of the game. So to me, what we have to do, and right now I will say, because of what Russia has done in the election, the chances of us being able to open a viable strategic dialogue at this point is relatively low. But I think there are an awful lot of people who say, look, we somehow have to get in a better spot, because the ramifications of a miscalculation or an inadvertent collision of our forces is not going to do anybody any good.
Thank you, sir. Megan Barnett, Joint Staff. You suggested a number of new investments or places where we might increase investment. Where would you propose we accept the offsets?
Well, the first thing I'll do is if we get extra money, the offset would be put it into the areas I talked about and not grow the force. We have a 1 million man ground force today. When you add up the active duty Army, the National Guard, the active duty Marine Corps, and the Reserve Marine Corps, I think we have 1.2 million strong ground force. Buying more BCTs makes absolutely no sense to me, none whatsoever, given the enduring overhead costs that you have to continue to pay. So as I said, I would put the money in honing the force and buying greater capability for the Army and the Marine Corps. And that's the first thing I would do. If we started to have cuts in our overall top line, and I don't see that happening anytime in the immediate future, then I would say I would take more risk in ground forces. I would take more risk in surface naval forces and put my money into submarines. I would start to move the Marine Corps into a high-low mix of some fifth gen and some a lot of predators that can mow the lawn in the Middle East quite effectively. And I would be doing exactly what the Air Force is doing now. Do I really need a J-STAR? Is the J-STAR going to survive? Are we going to get the J-STAR close enough to the, against the Russian anti-access area denial network and the China? No, probably not. So let's go after something else. So my frame of mind was I'm expecting that the Department of Defense will get more money. I'm absolutely certain that the president wants to provide more money to the department. And the only thing, my frame of mind is, let's not put the money in force structure right now. Let's put the money in addressing these other things that would make the force we have much, much more lethal and effective. Next time I come, I'll know exactly what I want to cut.
Sir, Peter Anzelka from Department of Army. Earlier, I'm sorry.
I don't see it.
Sorry.
Oh, there you are.
Yeah, earlier you mentioned the increased risk of proxy wars.
Yeah.
And do you foresee in the future that it will continue to be contained in the Middle East, or do you think there's a increased risk of them jumping to other geographic areas?
I make no prognostication on that. We're always surprised where we wind up fighting. Let me say this. I believe every single one of the state adversaries we have right now are conventionally deterred. The Russians are not acting as though they're itching for a fight. They are trying to destabilize the alliance. Yes, absolutely. But I just don't see Putin saying, let me risk an Article 5 trigger against NATO. There's no question the Chinese have no interest in taking on the United States, but they want to be damn sure if the United States intervenes in their region that they have the option to either deter, delay, or defeat if necessary. Iran is not going to start a conventional war. They will get crushed like a cockroach. And North Korea is going after nuclear weapons because they want to deter what they consider to be a high probability of a conventional attack and a regime decapitation strike. So all of the state powers that we worry about all the time, I believe, are conventionally deterred. And they are competing with us in other ways. You know, the Russians go after a strategy of indirect action. The Chinese, it's a grand strategy of economic co-option, subversion. The Iranians do mainly Quds Force and going through their own proxies, et cetera. And the North Koreans do what North Koreans do. They, you know, they say, look at me, I'm a threat, don't mess with me. So I think the likelihood is we might wind up in a proxy war somewhere that we have no clue where it might be. And so I don't know. I wouldn't want to make a guess.
Jim Stark, retired Navy over here.
Hi, Jim.
Hi. Good to see you again, sir. You made a very convincing case for developing a new strategy and reallocating funds within the defense budget. But are we going to be able to get to where we need to be without having major changes in our fairly bureaucratic and sclerotic defense procurement system? And if you could change things, what would you do?
Well, look, the two smartest people that I knew about, no, I guess two smartest people I know, who understand the defense acquisition program are Ash Carter and Frank Kendall. Both of them believed strongly that the split of AT&L into an Undersecretary of Defense for Research and Engineering and an Undersecretary of Defense for Acquisition and Sustainment was a major, major mistake. I philosophically was not so repelled by it because I saw the benefits of an Undersecretary of Defense for R&E that really focused, and this is what this person is designed to do. It's going to be Mike Griffin, if inshallah, and he gets confirmed. Focus on the totality of the R&D budget, all $72 billion, and take a look at these things and make a coherent department R&D approach and really go after rapid prototyping and fast failures. Now, the person who talks most eloquently about this is John Hyten, our strategic commander. And he said, look, if you take a look at what we did between 1956 and 1962 when we, you know, fielded 1,000 Minuteman, you know, after going through the Atlas and then the Titan, he said, I can't remember how many failures we had, but it was a failure like every day. You know, the old videos of these things are pretty awesome. You know, they go off the pad and then they fall on the pad. He said you couldn't do that today because Congress wouldn't allow you to fail. So the whole thing is to go rapid prototyping, push the failure, move quickly, and that's what R&E is designed to do. Acquisition and sustainment is designed to procure platforms that we want in our forces as fast, as economically as we possibly can, and we want to reduce their life cycle cost. That's righteous too. The other aspect of this, though, that is often forgotten in the split is the delegation of acquisition authority to the MILDEPs. So Will Roper, you know, the head of the Strategic Capabilities Office, he is most likely going to be the acquisition executive in the U.S. Air Force. Hondo Gertz, who came out of Softworks, he's going to be the acquisition executive in the Navy. And I can't remember the name of the Army acquisition executive who's coming out of business. So the hope is you split, you really start going after innovation and getting after AI in a strategic manner and hypersonics and lasers, whatever you want to go for. You do all sorts of prototyping. The one danger, and this is the danger that both Ash and Frank were worried about, is the valley of death between prototypes and production. And if this split widens the valley of death or deepens it, that's going to be a bad thing. So we got to watch out for that. But then you get all this engine of innovation at the services, and you hope that the whole thing becomes supercharged. Meanwhile, ANS is really focused on delayering regulations so that you can do more rapid stuff. Now, I'm the first one to say that we often convince ourselves that a reorganization will solve all our problems. And I can certainly say maybe, but that's all I'll say. You know, the services used to have acquisition authority. I think the Spruance Destroyer was the last straw that said, the Packard Commission said, man, we need to do a lot better, so we're going to bring it up and centralize it. Now, over this time, we added on a whole lot of bolts. We bolted on stuff and regulations. But it is not axiomatic that if you delegate acquisition authority to the services, that it will automatically be good. You know, we've got to prove ourselves. The other thing is, the SASC is looking at this hard. And they said, if you're approaching this like a jobs program, and all you're going to do is take the jobs that were in ATL and move them down to the services, we're not going to be happy about this. We believe that this is going to save a lot of people because you have to delayer and you got to get rid of all these people who say no. Hammer, yeah. I don't know. I mean, one of the things we worry about is, do the services have the bench depth right now to take on these big MDAPs? Or is it going to take them some time to grow up, I mean, grow their expertise? So I applaud the plan. I applaud what the SASC did. I applaud Secretary Mattis's adoption of it. And I think what we have to do now is really just keep our eye on the ball. It's all about velocity of innovation, velocity of getting capabilities to the warfighter faster. And if this doesn't work, then we better say, we failed, let's do it again.
Okay. Sorry, but we're gonna call it a night. Thank you, sir, very much.
I can take one more, simply because I'm having so much fun. And I have to drive myself home, and I'm not looking forward to that. But this is the last one.
Good evening, sir. Nick Sanderman. I'm an Australian LO in the Pentagon. Question referring to, you mentioned a number of times in your presentation about the preservation and development of talent in the department. Putting that in the context of the third offset and the relationship with the industry, could you comment on perhaps a need to change or have a different approach with industry in the way the department approaches industry?
Yeah, it's a good one. It used to be that the number one, Eric Schmidt from Alphabet, Google, this morning at an AI conference I attended, said the number one major used to be economics. And for the first time now, it's computer science. And he says, look, people who come out of a good school with a computer science degree or machine learning or they're good coders, they'll get a $2 million package by the big powerhouses like Google and Facebook. And we'll never be able to compete with them. So this is the way I would approach the problem. I would have a National Reserve AI Training Corps. And what would happen is the department would say, in these five disciplines, computer science, computer vision, machine learning, algorithmic warfare, we will give you a full ride to any school you want to go to. All you got to do is graduate with a B average, I'm making this up, and then you'll go in, it will treat you like you were in the National Guard. And once a month, you're going to go to the nearest military installation. You're going to learn about the operational problems that they have. And you're going to help them think about how to solve them with machine learning and AI, et cetera. And then once a year, 30 days a year, you're going to go out on a major exercise like a RIMPAC, and you're going to help them think through that. And that's, you can go work with Google. You can go work with Facebook. You can get billions and billions of dollars. But for us giving you a full ride, you're going to help us solve our big problems. Now, the one thing that I know is we have cool problems that people want to work on. And I believe something like this, if we did this in a national way, that we could swing it. The way the Chinese are doing it is they're just buying up all the talent. They're saying, how much is Google giving you? They're giving me $1 million a year and a house on the beach. Well, we'll give you $2 million a year in a high-rise in Shanghai. And they're buying out the talent. It's unbelievable. I believe the Sputnik moment has arrived. The Sputnik moment was the Chinese AI national plan. We, as a nation, need to respond. And just like in 1958, we said, okay, we're going to have a military side and a civilian side. NASA's going to do the civilian side, and the military's going to do this. We're going to have to do that. We're going to have AI centers of excellence. We're going to have to figure out new ways to provide grants to our universities. we can do what we do well. We do these type of things really, really well. But I'm just afraid that we're missing the Sputnik moment. But the talent competition is going to be dispositive. I mean, that's going to be what really wins or loses in the end. Thank you very, very much, Duncan, for
Thank you.
The invitation.